Okay, so we shared at least one photo, hopefully, down at Southwestern College, where I also teach this class. There's an assignment for every lesson, for every social network that we learn about. There's an assignment. And so the assignment that I would give with Instagram is that you have to post something new every day. So every day you would post a brand new photo on Instagram or video. So that helps you, of course, to understand the concept of using Instagram on a regular basis. And so obviously that's not in this class. There's no homework in this class, but if you want to challenge yourself, especially to get better, you do need to post often. So if you post one picture every day, one picture about your product, about your brand, and so forth, that'll help you get better at Instagram. So let's say you're trying to build followers. If you go over to, you're on your home screen, and then you click on the magnifying glass, that's your central hub for search and trends and such. So you've got search at the top, you've got different sorts of main topics at the top, election, spotlight on Copenhagen. So these are topics that a lot of people are posting about. If you look, let's see what's going on with the election. Right there, you're going to see the Instagram accounts, apparently, of a bunch of candidates, specifically the Democratic candidates, because the debate was on last night. And so you can see what the candidates are doing on Instagram. Let's see this other one, Spotlight in Copenhagen. So this is Destination Copenhagen, and it's different photos and some video about the place. The point of this is that then you can also look at trending tags. These are the tags that people are using, cookies, for apparently for some reason. So if I was a bakery, and I look here, I see one of these hashtags is popular. I might try to use them because my picture could show up there as well. If you go to one of those hashtags, you're gonna start to see all of these pictures. And now there are rules on Instagram about the kind of content. It's very, very limited in forms of in some matters that people feel it's too limited, such as artistic depictions of nudity or more adult material like that. That's prohibited on Instagram, basically. So overall, that's why you had that when you were downloading it, some of you had seen that it had said that teen rating, because apps have ratings like movies. All ages, teens, over 18, etc. So Instagram had the teen rating, which of course is subjective, but I'm searching there on cookies and I'm seeing a bunch of cookies. And you say, great, I see lots of cookies. How does that matter to me? I'm a bakery. So what I'm going to do is, if I go to any particular picture, and I see all of these cookies, and this is the first time I use this projector, so I don't know if I can make it look better. But let's say right here, I'm looking at that particular photo. I also see comments. And it looks pretty terrible. But there's comments right there, and people are commenting. So what you could do is, let's say, Live Fit and Fuel. If you tap on anyone's name, it will then show you their particular profile, their particular photos, and then you've got the follow button at the top, right over here. So the follow button. So just like on Twitter or any other network where you follow accounts, some of the accounts will follow you back. So one technique to get followers is that when you follow accounts, you will get followers back as well. Obviously, that doesn't mean follow any random account. You want to follow accounts related to topics that your business is about. And the way I'm figuring that out is by searching a hashtag that is of particular importance to my brand. So this one, La Fleur Cupcakes. So if you give yourself like 5 minutes a day as a goal, spend 5 minutes searching and following accounts, however many you end up following, 2 or 3 or 10 or 20, whatever. You followed some accounts, you do a little bit at a time because I believe there are limits. If you follow 100 accounts every hour, Instagram's gonna see there's something going on here. This must be a spam account because that's what spammers do. So if you set a goal of just spending a couple of minutes every day, you will then start to reach an audience that might care about your particular products. These are the things that are trending. You can, of course, always do your own search at the top. There's a search. And it might show me top or people, tags, etc. Let's say cakes. So this is going to pull up accounts that have cakes in the title, or the hashtag cakes. So again, I'm searching a particular hashtag. At the top, it's suggesting to me. It's suggesting cake and Cakestagram. Let's see if I can do this. See, at the top it says related cake, Cakestagram, cupcakes. Birthday. And so when you search these different hashtags or people, the point is you're going to try to reach out to make a connection. And those that care about a particular topic. So the usage of Instagram is pretty straightforward. I think it's more about how to use it creatively. And what we'll do is if anyone has questions, specific questions, we'll answer those. Yes.
So I've taken your blogging, SEO. and the social media. And pragmatically, I'm sitting here I just heard you say post every day.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just thinking, if you're a small organization and you want to use social media, and the idea is to post regularly,
mm-hmm.
and respond and give followers. If you were just trying to do Instagram, blogging, you know, Facebook, Twitter, you could spend a good portion of your time doing that.
Mm-hmm.
So I was wondering what might be a good strategy plan for using the social media to increase visibility, get your message out when you're a small organization.
You could choose that one day, Monday, will be your Twitter day.
Mm-hmm.
Tuesday will be your Instagram day. Wednesday will be your blog day. You can break it down like that, because you will get more visibility inherently by using all of the social networks, but that's obviously a lot of work. So if you decide that one day will be this network, that way you can focus on one particular network. So that's one of the best advice that I can give you, because you're going to see that it's so nebulous, so many things to do. But if you focus like that, break it down by day. This day is Instagram day. So today I'm going to post something on Instagram. I might have said, okay, every day post something on Instagram. That obviously assumes you have all of that time. But it's perfectly fine that if you're doing every Monday a brand new Instagram post, you're still going to post one new thing every week on Instagram. You're going to post something new on Twitter and so forth on a regular basis. Does that make sense?
Right.
Thanks.
I'm thinking the posting's fine, but if you're looking at the followers, and new followers that you might get, do you really want to wait until a week to respond or to interact with them?
Well, that assumes you're getting interactions, and maybe in the beginning you're not, and that's why you're trying to build that snowball. Of once a week you're posting something so that it adds up down the road. Now, eventually, then you will have interaction, and then it wouldn't be a good idea to wait a whole week to reply. So then you have to shift your strategy in that, okay, which are the networks that are getting the most results? So if I'm trying and spinning my wheels on Twitter and it's not quite working, maybe I can decide either try harder on Twitter or drop Twitter. That's fine. You have plenty of other networks that you could work with. And maybe you're seeing Instagram is the one that's working really well. The one where you're getting followers, the one where you're getting comments and such. If that's happening, then that's the one you're going to say, well, I was doing Instagram only on Mondays, but because it's not working for Twitter, so then I'm going to do it Monday and Tuesday. So substitute the day that was on a network that was not working. There's no one-size-fits-all also, unfortunately. That's why social media is a full-time job. That's why companies can be hired to do it. And then so if you're doing it yourself as a small business, honestly, you have a lot of work to do. And there's no easy answer to say how to do it all. It really is learning the network, seeing what works for you, what is effective for your brand, and what time do you have to devote to it. In my company, I can just talk in those sorts of terms. There's two people working on this stuff all the time, and we're working on it literally all the time. If I'm over having a lunch before this class and something pops up here in my notification that the client got a brand new reply on Twitter, I'm going to stop everything and answer that. That might not be the best strategy for everyone, but that works for my company and the people working in my team to kind of always be on call, which again is not always the best or most attainable for everyone. So it's just keep at it. If you don't like it, don't do it. If you do like it, keep doing it. You're going to see it paying off. Question?
Just another side of that, or to add to this discussion, I took a little marketing, a marketing class for small businesses, and she advised that you not try to do it all, that you pick two or three of your favorites that you'll actually use and like and will stick to, rather than having all these open accounts that are inactive. That makes you look bad. You have an Instagram that does nothing, or a Twitter where you haven't logged in 2 months.
You might not know which you like or which you're good at, however, until you try it. So
yeah.
There is something to be said about that. Obviously, if you've got too much going on, you're going to be less inclined to do anything. And the thing that I would say about the inactive account, I would still claim a profile even if you're not going to use it, because when you eventually come back and you do want to use it, it might be taken. You see, the name is taken. And if you didn't claim it 2 months ago when you were claiming all the networks, you say, well, I'm never going to use Instagram. And then you found out that Instagram now is number one that you need to use. You didn't claim your name 2 months ago. Someone else took it. And then unfortunately, these networks are pretty bad at having the legitimate owner use an Instagram. What I mean is that if I want Victor Campos on Instagram, someone probably took it years ago. But someone hasn't been using it in a year. But Instagram has no way for me to take it because I'm going to use it every day. And Victor Campos in Brazil is not using it for a year, but there's no way for me to take that name. Instagram, none of the networks do that. They're not good at that. Maybe they will do properly later, but right now, if a name is taken, basically you're not going to get it unless you're a celebrity. Unless you're big enough that you can really ask the companies to intervene for you, but us little people, we're never going to get the name if someone hasn't used it in 5 years, unless they change things. I thought I saw another hand. Yes?
Sometimes when I'm posting, I notice something comes up about boosting your post.
Mm-hmm.
What is that exactly?
That's very new, actually. You didn't see that probably 3 weeks ago. Boosting posts. That sounds familiar. Did we ever talk about boosting posts before in this class? Facebook. We talked about it in the days of Facebook last month. On Facebook, you can pay to make your photo or your content on Facebook be more visible. You're boosting it. Instagram, because they're owned by Facebook, they've just started to roll that out. You're going to be able to pay to get your photo on Instagram to be viewed by more people. And so there's good and bad of that, of course. The good is you're going to reach more people. The bad is you're going to pay. And if you have the thought that I would never pay for any of this, a tweet should be free and Facebook should be free. And yes, for people, it will be free, but for companies, you need to drop that attitude, because for companies, really the only way you're going to stand out is to either be already have a huge audience following you into social media or pay to start to build that audience. That doesn't mean you're going to be paying $100 every day or every week or whatever. You can set a budget of $100 for 1 year and then divide that up into different portions throughout the year. $100 is very doable in a whole year. And I haven't looked at it myself on Instagram because it's so new. I don't know all the nuances yet. But I know, like for Facebook, for example, you can get some activity for $1. You can get more activity for $5. And guess what? Even more activity for $100. But you don't need to pay all of that amount. It is valuable because marketing, advertising, it's very hard to do it effectively for free. So that billboard that you see, that radio ad that you hear, that TV spot that you hear, that flyer that gets put on your windshield, some amount of money was transacted for all of that. And for a lot of people, that flyer on that windshield is going to get thrown away. But for some amount of people, that flyer is going to pay off, and the company is going to recoup their investment. Same thing with an Instagram photo. I may take a quick photo. Let's say I'm a veterinarian. I take a quick photo of a very cute cat that we just, you know, gave their medications to, and then I boost it on Instagram. I don't know the price structure at all. Like I said, I'm not educated enough in it. But then that gets sent out to, let's say, 500 more people than normally would see it. And let's say 1% of that, it reached, that's five people, right? 500 is five people. Well, the 5% that it reached, of those five people that actually come and get their cats vaccinated, I made my money back and more. So it is an investment, literally, of time and money. And that's really the way things are going with all of this social media for people, for better or for worse, and for businesses. Question?
I'm not really sure. I'm on the homepage, and I then went to search, and I found a beautiful photo in the Norway in Copenhagen,
mm-hmm.
which I went to post to my my homepage, and I tapped on it, and I still.
Well, let me stop you there. Why do you want to post someone else's photo?
Well, I thought that's what you were showing us how to do.
Yes, but let me ask you, why would you want to post someone else's photo?
Well, it was rather interesting for a fish. It was a video of some fish just moving around. Like
how does that relate to your brand?
Well, photography, of course, is one brand. So I had written down somewhere where it is now, but a hashtag and the word photography.
Uh-huh.
And then from there, I pushed the search button to access that photo again. Tapped on the photo, but I didn't copy it. So I'm not sure if I missed the beat.
Well, going back to the concept, like right here, I'm loading up the Rhyolite Ghost Town. I did not shoot this photo. And if I wanted to share someone else's photo, you should be able to see this bending arrow. Actually, I should be showing it here. So I did go into the search, and I'm seeing someone else's photo. And my projector here is terrible, but there is a bent arrow in that area right there.
Yeah, I see that.
Yeah, tap that.
So,
yes, so then this is going to be shared to other people on Instagram. That's one way to share it then with your followers. You don't have any followers. You don't have any connections, so there's no one to share it to.
Yeah, and I can't just add them here from this place.
Well, how would you know what their...
I'd have to look up their email address?
No, you'd have to connect with them on Instagram.
Oh, I see. So that's... Yeah, well, how would I know
that? So that's why my point is, you might not want to do that too much. You want to share your own stuff.
Yeah.
I did talk about in the previous month, I think, the 80-20 percent rule, where I said 80% should be original stuff and 20% should be other people's stuff. So this could be part of that 20% that I'm sharing it, but really you're going to spend more of your time sharing your own photos. Because if I'm sharing this great photo of a place I've never been to, what's the point? It's interesting to people, but how does that really help my brand? Yes. We have also, which, because they're so integrated, if you click the three dots on a particular photo, you've got share to Facebook, so that's another way to share. But again, how much are you going to share of other people's work as opposed to your own? Only 20%, I would say. You're going to be shooting your own photos. And they don't have to be professional like all of these that I see here. This to me doesn't look professional, but it's not a bad photo. It's just a photo of a location, and they shared it. Great. And it got 452 likes. Well, that must mean also, because if I look at the profile, Elizabeth Bethreen, she's only got 192 followers. But she had lots of activity, because guess what? Interesting photos. She's probably posting on a regular basis. And that's what everyone is supposed to do, because it's very visual. Instagram is very visual. You want to share interesting looking things as much as possible.
So at some point, I need to go back and add a following from Facebook? Is that what you're saying? Twitter or Facebook?
Yes, that's one way. Or also what I said a moment ago about your searching. And then you're going to follow accounts on Instagram.
Follow accounts on Instagram. So that's where you're looking at cookies?
Yes. All right, any other questions in general about Instagram? So I'm going to pull up here my web browser. Thank you. And I'm going to go over, I believe I mentioned it before, socialmediaexaminer.com. We mentioned it last time when we were going to get into LinkedIn. Because I'm going to search on the categories over there. I'm going to search for Instagram. I'm going to search, what is this popular social media blog talking about when it comes to Instagram, and what can I learn? So socialmediaexaminer.com, and then I'm going to search Instagram. I'm starting to write Instagram, and it might give me different pop-up suggestions, but I'm going to search Instagram. And we're going to get, in my case here, 1,700 results. How do you know what the good ones are? One way is check the date. July 2015. That wasn't too long ago. January 2015. Well, that was 10 months ago, but still not so old. December. It's getting a little older. And then if I see some article that was from 2013, I wouldn't trust it. July 8th, 2013. How to use Instagram video for marketing. The reason I wouldn't trust the older ones is because this stuff changes. Social networks change. Technology changes. I'm showing you my screen on my phone, and it looks different than your screen, and everyone's getting confused because things change. And so if you look at articles that are too old, quote-unquote too old, they might not be giving you relevant information. How old is too old? I can't exactly tell you. It depends on the network, but I would say 1 year. If it's older than 1 year, you might want to start thinking about it. Is that still relevant? Because a lot happens in a year, especially in technology. So I could look at that video one, but there's probably a newer one, and I think this goes in order, probably. But I'm going to try to click on one of the newer results, which is 13 Instagram marketing tips from the experts. That one says July 2015. So there's the audio version of this article, which is nice because you can download it and put it on your phone and listen to it on the commute, during the commute. But let's see, shoot square. Your Instagram feed is only as good as your photographs. One of the best ways to save time is compose better photos is to shoot square photos. This has already changed also because Instagram has now allowed us to do horizontal photos or vertical photos. What it's telling you this is, if you've got an app that lets you shoot square photos, then that's an extra step that you won't have to do in the Instagram app. But that's kind of a moot point now. You can do full-size photos now if you want. Use a customized link shortener to track traffic. So this is kind of advanced, actually. But it's saying here, you're going to be able to put links in your photos. Not literally on the photo, because nothing will happen if someone clicks it. It's talking about putting a link in your description. Remember when it asked for that caption? You can put a link in there. So I can put victor.com. But what this is saying is, one of the most important things marketers need to know is how well their Instagram account is driving traffic and leads. So you're not going to know really how many people have clicked on a link in Instagram unless you follow this tip, which is to use a link shortener. Have you heard of the website Bitly? B-I-T-L-Y, Bitly? If you haven't, bitly.com is a website that takes an address, a web address, and shortens it down, or lets you customize it, and the more important aspect of it is that it then tracks who has clicked on it. It gives you statistics of who has clicked on a link. If I share my link, victor.com, to all my social networks, I might not have a very accurate representation of the traffic that I'm getting from Instagram, from Twitter, because they're all using that same link. But if I first go to Bitly and copy my address, victor.com, and paste it into Bitly, it will give me a more unique address. And then I can use that address on Instagram, in a different version on Twitter, in a different version on Facebook. Then I can log into Bitly and it'll show me. You got 40 clicks on the Instagram link, 2 clicks on the Facebook, and 27 on the Twitter link. If I had only used victor.com, I'd just get all that information muddled together. But by using a service like Bitly, I can create these addresses that I can fully track who clicked on them. I can track my leads. Leads could then lead toward conversions, which could be sales and such. So again, it's kind of advanced. I talked about it in general terms, but I believe if you follow some of these links, they'll tell you more detail. Create a different Bitly link each time you change the link for a new landing page, campaign, or default page to continuously track success. Again, that sounds kind of advanced, and it is. It's basically using a different link for every social network. That way you can track more accurately where's my traffic coming from. Notice the bio, the biography. It is important to fill out that biography. There's a tip about cross-promoting. So it says you can tag others. This is what I mentioned earlier about tagging people on your post. Let's say I have this bakery, and I have the main company Instagram. But I have a personal one, and my two other bakers, they have personal ones. So, me, the two other bakers, and the business, that's 4 Instagram accounts that could be cross-promoting each other. Because maybe one of the bakers in my company is a superstar on Instagram. So if she once in a while promotes the main business, that's going to bring some traffic from her popular account. From our business account, we may be mentioning her, tagging her, giving her traffic. So cross-promoting, that all of these accounts that are related to each other are, not all the time, but that they are linking to each other, tagging each other, promoting each other. We have hashtags. We saw in the Explore feature, these are the popular things. The cookies tag was popular. Did you know you can search hashtags emojis? So you don't have to search for hashtag pizza. You can search for hashtag the icon of pizza. That will also get you traffic results. So if you don't know how to use emoji, you need to look it up on your phone. Those little icons, those little pizza icons, and the little faces, and the little ghosts, and all of that. Every smartphone has the ability to add those icons. You just have to find out how to turn it on yours. Because there's a whole subculture of people using icons as hashtags instead of words.
Is that an app?
It's usually built into your phone in the settings somewhere. So if you've got a marketing funnel set up, which are different steps along the process, because step zero is you have a potential client, and then the final step is you've sold them something. In between, there's a lot of steps. There's a funnel that goes from someone not being a customer to someone being a customer, but there's a lot of steps. In between all of those steps, they can be variable, but they depend on your particular company. Maybe all you need is to get their email so you can sell them something. That's one of the steps in the funnel, for example. So here it's talking about you can use Instagram to bring people to different steps of your funnel, different parts of your funnel, to get them closer to sell them something. For example, here, to move your users further down the funnel, you should consider identifying ways to capture your followers' emails. One of the best ways to capture your followers' email is to ask for it. So if you've got an Instagram photo, this one says, summer kicks. Our cotton denim lace-ups are perfect for everything summer that follows you. Link in bio. They added that photo. They added in the caption that text, a couple of hashtags, and then they also said the link for that is in the biography. Because remember, you could edit your biography and put whatever link you want there. So if you're only putting your main home page, you might not really be leading them as close as possible to actually making a sale. Here it's showing that they're taking advantage of the link and the bio to lead them more directly to an actual sale or an actual product.
Hashtag leads them to your website?
No. The link leads them to your website. The hashtag is only to keep searching on Instagram. Mix videos and photos. Okay, so you're doing pictures, but you've also got the ability to do video. So don't forget about video. Encourage your fans to create your own videos and collect them on your page. So some of these ideas are kind of general because, okay, how do I collect them on my page? I would like that to be explained much more in detail for beginners. But basically, did you notice that when you were on your app, one of the options that you have on Instagram, when you click the three button, the three little dots, one of the options there is you might see copy share URL. That's the address of that particular post. So if you copy that address there, you can compile a list of all of these great videos that people are creating in your name. What do you do with them? Well, then you put them on your web page. Obviously, that means you have a web page to put them on. So sometimes these instructions, unfortunately, do assume that you have a lot of experience in some of this basic stuff. Because the concept here is, great, I do want to encourage people to post photos and video of my product. But how do I collect them? Like I said, you're going to have to manually, and it takes time and effort. That's why this is a full-time job. You're going to copy that share URL, and once you have that, you can then do something with it. It's talking about then sponsored ads or boosted posts, just like on Facebook, we're going to be able to start to pay to see more or to get more exposure. As of this writing, it said, these features are still in their infancy and only select brands working in partnership with Instagram are using them, but expect this to take off dramatically. So if you did see on your particular Instagram that there is the option to start boosting right now, I would check it out. I would take advantage of it because not everyone has this feature yet. If you've got the feature, you've got one step ahead of the competition. So this one reminds you about linking to your content, although it says that adding a link in the description or the caption of the photo might not work. You always have the option to add a link in your biography. Notice what Mashable is doing here. in their biography. They wrote a little blurb, and then they wrote, use the hashtag MashPicks for a chance to be featured. So that's one way. People love to get their 15 minutes of internet fame. So if you dangle the possibility that they will get featured, that they will get some amount of fame if they use your hashtag, that's going to have people, hopefully, eager to start using that hashtag. That's going to build brand awareness for your product. And then if you do follow through, you're going to feature their photo on your website, for example. Or you can share their photo.
But then you're leaving yourself wide open to just about anything, right?
Yeah, unfortunately, yeah. That is the downside of it. If you let people do that, then yeah. If you ask people, that usually doesn't happen to like the small companies and such. It's really the big companies are the ones that are targeting. Those are the ones that are gonna get maybe the harassment and such, unfortunately.
So to create, we create an account. Now to create a business account, we go in and just do the same thing again?
Yes, there's no difference between the business and the personal ones at the moment. So you just need to create another one.
So, but we couldn't use, we wouldn't use the same email. We'd use a different email.
You'd have to use a different email, yes. The email has to be unique per account. Okay, number 11 here. Make graphics share-worthy. Pairing images with captions is an effective way to engage your audience. So let's say you have a photo, and then you also put some text, some inspirational text, for example, that will hopefully entice your followers to share it, to be your own, to be cheerleaders for you, to be your marketers, free marketers for you. How to do that? There's no way to do this on the Instagram app itself. You can't, at the moment, add text directly to your photos. You have to use an extra app to do that. One popular one, which is its own can of worms, is one called Snapchat. So if you've heard of Snapchat, that's another app. It has its own social network and all of that, but that's a way to that's a way to draw on your photos, add text to your photos, add stickers to your photos. So let's say you take some photos in Snapchat, you add these photo, you add these stickers and text and such, and then you upload them to Instagram. Like I said, there's also Camera 360. Very popular. It's got 3 million votes. So this is mixing one app with Instagram. There's no shortage of creativity when it comes to apps, because then you you get these other you get these features of these other apps, combine them with Instagram, and that's what many companies do nowadays. This is a good one here. This is develop an editorial calendar. The calendar basically is that you're planning how you're going to be posting. You're planning, again, that every Monday you're going to do this kind of post. Every Wednesday you're going to do that kind of post. Every Friday you'll do this kind of post. Or maybe this whole month you're going to be focusing on cat pictures, and next month you're going to be focused on landscape pictures. So if you want rigidity and a plan like this, this is very good. Develop a calendar.
a limit to how many posts you can do on in a day? Are they?
In a day, probably, but it's probably like 100. So I don't think most people are going to post that much. No. No, I wouldn't go overboard like with 100 photos a day and following 200 accounts per day and such. I think there are limits. I'm not sure what they are, but any of those that are like spammy, like too much, will be problematic. Yes.
So I think most of us have pretty decent cameras on our phones, but say someone who has a low-end phone, is that going to impact like the Instagram presentation?
It will, unfortunately. So if you've got like a 2-megapixel phone, and then you're trying to take these photos and filter them and upload them, they might not look the best because Instagram works with what you give it. So if you give it a low quality photo, it's not gonna look that good once you upload it. So one way around it also then is to use another photo, like another camera, and then transfer that photo to the smartphone. If the smartphone is not capable of taking good photos, take it on a, you know, real camera, point and shoot or whatever, and then transfer it to your phone and then use it there.
So it's a 5-megapixel.
That's more than enough. 5 megapixel is more than enough. Yes.
So start with a 5. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Is there any
Wi-Fi in my camera itself? And so when I do
No, you're not going to be able to do that. You can only upload to Instagram through the Instagram app. So you're going to need to get your photos from your camera onto your phone. Once they're on the phone, then you can upload them to Instagram.
So how do you access them then from your app?
From the Instagram app?
Because once I've been able to access today, we're limited to the ones I took on the cell phone.
That's what I'm saying. You're going to need to find a way to transfer them from your camera to your phone. One possible way is to use Dropbox. If your camera can connect to Dropbox, you can upload your photos to Dropbox, and then you get the free Dropbox app on your phone, and both your phone and your camera will be accessing the same Dropbox account, and therefore you'll be able to get that photo and upload it to Instagram.
I'm currently using Picasa. Would that be another label?
Possibly. I haven't used it, so I can't really confirm it, but probably. There's a scheduling tools link here under number 12. Let me check that out, because again, we always have ideas, but not enough time. So this is 4 Instagram tools for scheduling updates. Now it is from November, that's just about a year old, so it might not be as relevant as it used to be. Let's see what we've got. Schedugram. Upload single photos, multiple photos, and videos. Schedugram. Latergram. Instapult. And Takeoff. And then he gives you good detail also about when to schedule. If there's some sort of conference, you're going to be in the conference itself. You might not have the time to be on Instagram or Twitter or whatever. So if you use these scheduling apps, this will do it for you while you live in the real world. So this particular this particular article might still be relevant if you look up, do they still have these apps? Because sometimes apps come and go for whatever reason. But here on Social Media Examiner, I found it through this, four Instagram tools for scheduling Instagram updates. The conclusion is there's no better way to step up your business game than to be active on Instagram. The platform is constantly making improvements so individuals and businesses can get more out of it. So these things change all the time. That's why what we might talk about today might still be relevant, might not be relevant. But the more you do it, the more you get comfortable. And following blogs like this one, Social Media Examiner, should help you keep up to date with this. Like here's a brand new article today about YouTube. We're going to talk about YouTube next week. This is the new research about YouTube. So I haven't seen this article yet. I want to look at it and see what it's about. YouTube video viewing time is surging. So that means more people are getting on YouTube. Ad revenue is expected to keep rising. So if you use YouTube, did you know you can actually make money off of YouTube? You can make videos on YouTube and get paid for your videos on YouTube. So this says you're gonna be making more and more money off of YouTube. And actually it does work. I've made a cool $11 off of YouTube.
And who sets the standard, you know, for the price of your
YouTube. Creation. YouTube. So it's sort of cynical, isn't it? YouTube will pay you on your YouTube videos, but YouTube decides how much your YouTube videos are worth.
What do you do?
I do videos about my hobbies and such as comic books or technology and things like that. How long are the videos?
Yeah.
They range, usually short, as we'll talk about next week, of all of the secrets of YouTube, but basically short videos, because it depends on your content. Some people will sit and watch a 15-minute video, because let's say it's a tutorial, but a lot of people might not. A lot of people might just want a 1-minute video. So we'll see next week all the nuances of YouTube. Yes.
So to make money on YouTube, you have to have a certain amount of views. Is that how it works?
To make the most money, yes, you need a lot of views and a lot of followers. But I don't have a lot of followers. I have an okay amount of views, so I am getting some revenue from it. But when we talk about it next time, we'll touch on that. It's called basically monetize. We're going to monetize our YouTube account. By default, it's not on by default. We have to activate that, and then we'll start to get money off of our YouTube videos. So this is just some data on YouTube. Young audiences follow brands on YouTube. So it looks like the statistics show that young audiences, however that's defined, a survey says that in February of this year, 75% of viewers aged 18 to 35 followed brands on YouTube. So brands, companies. We are brands here, probably. We are companies. So people, young people, 18 to 35, are going to be following companies, not just the crazy guy that you know, runs through a room full of ping pong balls or whatever that you see on YouTube. They're going to follow companies too: Nike, McDonald's, Joe's Bakery, etc. So we're going to wrap up the lecture about Instagram right now. Remember, it's really about you exploring it. This class is, in general, an overview, a smorgasbord about these different networks. Then you can decide which you like, which are effective for you, and where you want to put more of your efforts and not. But if you don't try them out, you might not realize, hey, actually, I'm pretty good at Snapchat. We're not going to get a chance to talk about Snapchat, but that's something else to look at. And there's Periscope. That's another cool app about video. In short, video is becoming more and more popular. So any final general questions about Instagram?
No, I did email, confirmed my email, and I have a lot more options.
That might be it then, right there, Nicole. If you haven't confirmed your email, you want to do that so that you get those extra options, just like Anande here.
Can I have my email on the cell phone?
Yeah. So we're going to end right now. We're going to have lab time until 4. And when we come back next time, we're going to use YouTube. You don't need to come with any video. I will provide you with a video. What we're going to do next week is learn how to take a video, how to use a video that's been recorded, and using free software, in this case Windows Movie Maker, how to edit the video, to cut out the silent parts, to put in cool background music, that sort of thing. You can do what we're going to learn here also in iMovie. So if you've got a Mac, you can have iMovie, which is free. If you've got Windows, you can use Windows Movie Maker. That's also free. So what we're going to do is use Windows Movie Maker. If you have your own Mac, you can bring it. But we'll use Windows in here. And whatever you learn here, you'll be able to apply on the Mac pretty much the same, except the icons will be a little different and such. And we'll learn how to edit a video and then, of course, create an account on YouTube and upload it and talk about techniques on YouTube and all of that. Possibly, depending on how we do, I'm going to say that possibly we might take 2 days on YouTube if you guys decide that. I'm planning on 1 day of YouTube and then the last day of class, which I would plan on being Yelp. But as we get on YouTube, we might decide, well, let's do 2 days on YouTube because that's such a big can of worms and it's very enjoyable. And as that article says right there, it's only going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. This says right here, you might not think about it, but oftentimes people think of YouTube as the second largest search engine. Google, YouTube, Bing, Yahoo, all of that. YouTube. People go on YouTube to search how to change my oil, how to learn to garden, how to bake a pie, how to set up a retirement account, how to this and that. It's a search engine. So if we create these videos that people could search for, you might also be able to earn money off of YouTube. Or, if you don't earn money, at least get traffic back to your website, to your company, or you might find that it's fun. So we're going to end at this point. We'll do some lab time when we come back next time. YouTube.
Next week, we need to